So we're going to start today with the easiest form of stonewall, which is dry stack. Now, easiest when you choose the right stone. The stone we've chosen for this is a very flat, very easy to work with. Lumpy bumpy stones, the real rocky field stone, New England style, beautiful walls, much harder to work with. They're more for an experienced stonemason. When you're doing a DIY stone wall, you want to start with something that you're not fighting the entire time. So a nice flat stone that's easy to work with is the best way to go. Dry stack is for certain applications. It's not meant to hold a lot of weight. So you don't want to do that for a true retaining wall. You don't want to do it if you're going up above 10 or 12 inches. We'll get into a different technique for that. Dry stack is simply kind of an edging look. It can retain, but it's not meant to hold a lot of weight. We're going to edge around this crepe myrtle today with a dry stack wall. Daniel has started the process just to show you how it, you know, how it looks as it moves along, but he's also going to show you some techniques of as you're beginning. He'll move the wall out to a section too to see kind of how he starts. It's important to start with a really level area. If you can do some digging out. With this one, it's not necessary to put gravel down. Some of the other applications will be putting gravel down prior to starting the stonework. So Daniel's going to start. He's going to choose some stone. And what you're doing, you want to try to overlap stone whenever possible so that you don't end up with a big seam down the middle. And selecting the right stone for each spot's important. You want to get started? So he's pre-selected some stone so that this doesn't take 2 hours. So it's easy for you to see what he's doing, but he's pre-selected some stone that'll fit right in there quite well. And you'll see he's keeping the straight edge along the front. The edge in the back doesn't really matter so much because you'll be filling that up with soil, plants, mulch. That side won't be seen. You want to keep your clean line on the front of the wall. It can be a little rustic. It depends on your style. You can really concentrate on making that line as neat as possible. Or you can make it as rustic and lumpy as possible, depending on the look that you like.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You want to set aside some of the larger pieces for your top pieces because they're going to cover up any of the jagged underneath parts. So he's choosing some of the larger, prettier pieces for the top. And then you'll fill in behind. No one will see when your wall is finished what it looks like behind. What they're going to see is the front. When you're building a stone wall to retain, you want it to batten into the hill more than you would on an edging wall. And what that means is if a wall goes straight up and down, it's more likely to keel over. You've got, it's simple physics. You've got pressure behind that wall that's going to knock it down. If you batten the wall, which means put it at an angle and tilt it, then it's got a competing force against that pressure out and it'll stay better. For a simple edging wall like this, you don't necessarily need to do that. But as you go up higher, you want to get a little tilt into the grade on that wall so that tree roots aren't going to knock it down, that sort of thing. Dry stack is probably the easiest form of wall because you don't have to cut as much. You notice Danielle cut a stone earlier just to get an edge off it, but he's not having to cut and select specific pieces. And feel free to ask questions anytime you want. Yes, sir.
So with this one, would you actually be worried in say a few years about any of the root growth pushing out on the wall?
So the question was, would we be worried in a few years about root growth pushing out on this wall? And the answer is yes, we would. If you're edging, we're edging it around a tree simply because that's what's here in this site. If you're edging a small floral bed, then that's not a problem. But if you're edging a tree bed, yes, you are concerned about root growth. And so coming further away from the trunk of the tree and then backfilling is better. But you want to be careful not to backfill against the trunk of the tree too much, because at the base of the tree it starts to flare out like this. Those are the buttress roots on the tree, And that's where the oxygen and CO2 exchange takes place. So you don't want to smother the tree. I see too many trees where people come up with a stone wall around it and then backfill. It's a slow death, but that tree will die.
So with this one, how much should you actually slope the wall?
On a wall like this, you really don't need to. It's as you're going up higher. Once you're going past maybe 10, 12 inches, you definitely want to get that tilt into the wall.
Thank you.
I had another question. Yes.
Thickness of the stone, is there a guideline as far as how thick the stone you select should be?
That's a good question. She was asking if there's a guideline as to how thick a stone we should be selecting. That's up to you. That's totally up to you. Thinner stones look better for low walls because you get more dimension to it. Thicker stones, of course, have more weight. They're better for taller walls. But a wall with building stone, with larger stone, just to do an edging like this, just design-wise, it's not going to look right. You won't have as attractive a face on it. Yes, sir?
Is there a reason we don't put any adhesive between the stones, concrete and sealant or something like that to prevent?
Tradition? So he asked, is there a reason we don't put any sealant between or any concrete or anything? We're going to do that on the next wall. But that's more a tradition for a dry stack wall, not to put any adhesive material. It also makes it more flexible so that over time, if you need to move it or if you see some movement in the wall, you can pull it out and change it a little bit. Roots can bother with it, animals can bother with it, and sometimes you have to do small repairs like that.
I have a question about backfilling. So we bought a house and the guy backfilled already this tree in our front yard.
Okay.
And so how do you pull that back? Because now all the roots, you know how the roots come up?
Mm-hmm.
Would that harm the tree by doing that?
Are you looking to build another wall in front of it?
Yeah,
you would come out further. I would pretty much leave those roots and leave that soil alone and say it was backfilled to where the wall is. I'd start your stone wall out here and come in and backfill behind the stone wall. Do as little as possible to disturb your tree roots when you're doing
installing the
wall.
Isn't that killing it, the fact that he's backfilled it over those buttress?
If they're over the buttress roots, excavate around that, pull the soil away as much as possible. Yes, sir.
Is it okay to put gravel and or some mortar as the base before you start?
Yes. So as you get higher on a wall, the question was, is it okay to put gravel or mortar or something behind the wall? As you get higher on a wall, the structure of the wall may become compromised if there's only soil behind it. So what we do is we put rubble. As he starts to break up stone, necesita piedra rota atrás de la cerca para explicarlo.
Okay.
Sí, para demostrarlo. Danielle's going to demonstrate rubble. And what rubble is when we've got a stone that's an ugly stone, and there are no ugly stones, but that's one that's going to be difficult to work with. He'll break it up or any pieces that you've used to fill in. Put it behind, because some of these top pieces are going to be a little unbalanced. They're a little larger than what's underneath them. So you can always use those behind. They're good for drainage and they're good for support. And so it can be gravel or it can be broken pieces of the stone that you have left over. Yes?
Now, what I meant though was before you start the wall, mm-hmm. if you put gravel as the base, sort of as the foundation for it?
You can. On an edging wall like this, you don't need to. We'll talk about that with the other walls. There are walls that it's really important to put gravel behind. This wall, what we're trying to demonstrate is this is the simplest, this is a beginner wall. This is where you get started in stone wall construction. As you get more confident, as you have more experience with it, you want to start on a larger wall, a bigger project, and you want real stability with it. It's not just a pretty edging wall. Then yes, digging a trench and adding gravel like we've done there really does help with their stability, because roots are going to move the soil compaction, animals crawling under, that sort of thing. So it does help to build a more stable base for it. Hey, good.
So I can't quite see the interlocking, but it looks like you're not interlocking quite as much as I would have thought.
Interlocking in what way?
Like, the same wood
overlap. Yeah, so right now he's kind of putting the top wall stones on here. So what Ewan was asking was about not having a seam that runs straight down the wall, but overlapping. ¿Puede demostrar, no quiero una línea enfrente? Exactamente. ¿Puede construirlo aquí, por favor? Okay. What he's going to show is how this is going to overlap the seams that you're seeing in front. Exactamente. Does that answer?
As much as you can, but
yes, you want to overlap as much as you can. You don't want a seam running straight up allows more force to push that wall apart. So any overlapping that you can do, not quite like brickwork, but any overlapping you can do adds to the strength of the wall. Okay.
How do you handle inclines or unlevel surfaces?
Try to level it out as much as you can first, but what happens often where this type of wall is built, you'll have a slope in the front yard or backyard, and you have a tree, and you're starting to see exposed roots because erosion has started to do that. Instead of building right where those roots are, come out, give that tree another foot or two of space, level that part of the ground, and even go underground if you want, so that some of the stone, like you're seeing here, is below the soil surface, and build your wall and batten it a little into the slope, and then backfill behind.
And you would taper it then, wouldn't you, if it's a pretty good incline?
Right, so what those end up looking like are smile walls. So the front of the wall, maybe this tall. The top of the wall stays level, but you're going up the hill as you come back. So the wall starts out pretty tall in the front and tapers back to when you hit grade with a cap, that's when you know to finish the wall, when that capping stone hits grade.
Two questions.
Sure.
So shit, because I've attempted this.
Okay.
It doesn't look as
he's got many, many, many years of experience building stone walls.
I figured you have to taper them.
Uh-huh.
But the base, should it be larger stones? And then
it does help to have, it depends on the height. It does help to have larger stones as your base or maybe a couple layers of stone.
Okay.
Even if they're small.
Separated them in sizes.
Sure.
And then try to work from there.
Uh-huh.
I also have some large stones. Can you incorporate a big stone in it?
Yes,
stone?
And that's a fantastic, incorporating a large stone like we did in that wall.
But actually to stick out?
You can. Did that at your house. Yes, we've done that in the past with walls that kind of have stones built into them that you can actually sit on or that can have pockets to put plants into. We're going to get into, I'm glad you brought that up, because when we move to this wall, we're going to get into incorporating larger stone into the wall for design purposes and as a way to end the wall. Yes?
Karen, for this application, you have to be very picky with the level as you go along. You kind of check the level of each layer of stone?
Yes. The question was, do we keep checking the level? And yes, we do, because you can be looking at it, and particularly, you know, if you're not standing back from the wall, if you're in working as close as Danielle is, sometimes it's hard to, you step back and the wall is gone like this. So he does run a level along the top. It doesn't have to stay perfectly level on the top, as long as it maintains a pretty consistent level.
Oh, this is the marquee. Mm-hmm. Donde está el nivel, si esta es la tapa, necesita poner el nivel y ahí ir poniendo las diferentes piedras de design para que dé el nivel, pero
right.
Solamente donde da la tapa.
Yeah, he's saying if you have trouble with it, if you're picking different stones and they're of different levels for your cap, because this isn't wood, this isn't a cut material that's all exactly perfect. You can support underneath some of those stones with little chips and little pieces to get them up so that the top is level. You keep working underneath it. Yes, sir?
So in conjunction with the leveling part, I know you want to keep it level, obviously, as the stones are this way.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any benefit or not to actually making the top level, either pitch back or pitch forward?
No, keep it as level as possible. Yep, you keep the top level as possible. These walls are not meant for people to walk on. So when we've built walls in the past, I've talked to people about, you know, are your kids going to climb on the top of it? Because kids do climb on the top of it. And I don't want you to have to yell at your kids, get off the wall, get off the wall. So if you're going to, if that's your reality and the kids are going to walk on the wall, great segue to the next wall. Concrete. Concrete is your friend. So we're moving to the next segment of our demonstration today, and this is a mortared stone wall. Mortar is for when your children want to walk on the top of the wall, or in my case, grandchildren, or when you need more strength to that wall, when there is a risk that roots will push it out, and when you're getting above the 8 or 10 inch height. If you're starting a mortared stone wall like we did, where it doesn't curve to a natural end, I love starting and ending a wall with a border, with a boulder. Boulders, to me, are beautiful. Every single one is different. You can get, you know, lumpy ones, square ones. This one is a little smaller than what we talk about as a huggable boulder. A huggable boulder means that it's about this big. Stone is a lot heavier than it looks. It's heavier than you think it is. So if you're working with something like that, please protect your back. A weight belt or a back support belt is important. When I was younger and I did more of this, I did some damage, and now I'm older and my back hurts a lot because I moved stone without really thinking about long term. I thought I was young, I thought I was strong, I can do this. Long term, it took its toll. So you really want to protect your back when you're working with anything that size that's heavy. So we had a question earlier about budgeting for these projects and whether it's a dry stack wall, a mortared stone wall. There are certain formulas, and inside we actually have a sheet of paper that breaks down the stone. Each pallet of stone here weighs about a ton, but it'll tell you how much coverage in that stone variety you'll get. Generally, if you're building a stone wall, 1 ton will stretch 14 feet long by 1 foot high. So if your wall's only 6 inches high, simple math, you're going to get 28 feet out of it. So when you are budgeting to buy stone, it's really helpful to lay a tape measure out or run a measuring wheel around where you're going to be doing those walls, because you'll look at something and say, oh, it's only 6 feet. I guarantee you it'll be 12. So make sure you're really measuring out, and come in and tell us how long your wall is going to be and how high, and we can help you make sure you choose the right amount of stone for your project so you don't run short or you don't run way over. For me, having leftover stone is always a benefit. That means I get to do a new project. So get to use, I can always find a way to use stone. Danielle has started this wall. And one thing he asked me to remind everyone is when you're doing a mortared wall, it's really important when you open up your pallet and start taking out stone to separate your pieces. So if you've got smaller pieces to one side, larger pieces that you're going to use for the cap, set aside. I always try to identify the most beautiful, you know. He pulled this mossy one out. I love it. It's already, that wall is already alive. It's gorgeous. So pull out some of those really special larger pieces and set those aside to use as your top. The stone, when you're doing the stonework, the mortar you want to choose is type S mortar mix, and it has some reinforcement in it. Simple product, you buy it at Lowe's, you mix it like Danielle has here, till you get kind of a pudding consistency there. You want it, you know, pudding, oatmeal, grits, that sort of consistency. As you keep working in it, if it gets harder for you to move around, add more water to it. It really is a feel thing. A lot of people say, well, to a bag, how many gallons of water do I use? Add it slowly and get it to that oatmeal mush feel. And that's really where you want it. And keep mixing it throughout. He's got a little extra water, so he's kind of pushed that to the side. He doesn't need that now. He'll move that back in as he needs to. simple mixing bucket, simple trowel. I've seen some really flexible, useless trowels. Get a good sturdy trowel. Okay, and Danielle's going to demonstrate how he lays the stone in. When we're finished filming, if you want to come around and look at the backside, you can see how messy that is. That doesn't matter. That's your strength back there. No one's ever going to see that once you backfill it. All they'll see is the front. Now he's using a stone hammer. Danielle, ¿puedo tener el martillo? Gracias. Stone hammers, wonderful things. Heavy flat end here, cutting end here. There's this guy at the flea market. You take your stone hammers to him. We used to do it about once a quarter, and he has a wheel, and he sharpens those blades on the back of the stone hammer. And I think if I were him, I'd charge way more than he does, but he's a cool guy. He's got a little sharpening system right on whetstone on the back of his pickup truck. I'm sorry?
Do we have any for sale?
Do we have these for sale? Oh. No, he just sharpens them for you there. We do have these for sale. But a stone hammer is going to be so much better than just a simple woodworking hammer. That's not what you want. This has a lot more weight in the head, and it's got that cutting end on the other side. And I'm going to give this back to him because he probably needs it. So what he's doing, what's fun about the mortar is you can add it in a thinner layer or a thicker layer, depending, to try to get that level. He's doing some smaller stones in here for support, and the mortar will hold those in place.
And he's the mortar on the back, so you don't see the mortar on the
exactly. This application, the mortar is not part of the look. You want this to look dry stack, but to have a lot more strength than a dry stack wall.
How much gap would you not want to try to make up with mortar?
That's up to you. Again, that's so the question was, how much gap do you want to leave? In a more rustic look wall, you can leave more gaps. If you want to be able to insert plant material, maybe some moss, some little tiny steppables, little cool little plants in between, leave yourself some gaps. If you want a very tight look, try to leave as little as possible. It's all stylistic there. And you
from
can,
a leveling perspective, how much would you want to try to make up with mortar before trying to actually use a stone?
Stone wherever possible. That's a great question. How much do you want to use the mortar for, and how much do you want to use the stone for? The stone's stronger. Use the stone wherever possible. The mortar is literally a cement. It's there to hold it all together, but don't build the whole back end up with stone, with mortar rather. You do want this to be able to weep a little. You want moisture to be able to escape behind the wall, because you don't want to end up with standing water behind it. So you want air and water to be able to escape through that wall. So you don't want completely concreted in on the backside. That's just there to hold it together. I love watching him work. He's so, so good at it. Yes, sir.
But this one doesn't need gravel at the base as well.
Again, depending on how high you go. Gravel at the base is always good for support. If you're going just as short as we've done here, you don't need it. You're getting up a foot or more, digging out a trench beneath that wall when you start and pouring in gravel is going to really add to the endurance of that wall. It'll make it last a lot longer because that gravel will kind of fill back in gaps as a root goes through or as water moves through. It really helps to stabilize it. And as you know, we don't have the world's greatest soil in North Carolina. We have terrible clay and some sand and funky things with some gumbo soil. We have some strange things that go on with our soil. So anything you can do to give a stronger base to that wall is good. You don't need to pour a concrete footer for a stone wall unless you're doing something, you know, that's in the multiple feet height. Yes, sir.
How many additional inches and or feet does a mortar wall buy you versus a dry stack?
Depending on the size, it can be almost limitless, depending on the size of the stone and the degree of the battening into the hill you've done. The question was, when you're mortaring, how many more feet high can you go? With skinny stone, don't go above maybe 2 feet at the most with very thin stone. The higher you're getting on the wall, the bigger your stone ought to be. So you move from thin wall stone to thick wall stone to building stone. Building stone, pieces like this. And building stone is for a really, really strong wall. Adding larger stones into the wall accomplishes many things. It adds beauty, it adds strength, it allows you to sit on that wall, and the wall goes faster. Look, with a stone that size, you've already built 2 feet of wall. Yes?
How long does the mortar stay workable?
The mortar stays workable as long as you keep adding water to it. He'll run out of mortar before it's not workable. And that's why you mix it in a small amount.
How long does it take to set?
Okay, so the question was, how long does it take a mortared wall to set? And that's an excellent question because it varies. Wouldn't have set yesterday in the pouring rain. It depends how moist it is. If it is hot and it is dry, that wall will set to where you can maybe sit on it within 48 hours. If we're consistently humid and moist and we're getting rain, you want to wait a week or so. It all depends on the temperature.
You don't want to be doing it the day before.
So it all depends on, you know, the moisture in the air. Another thing factor that brings up is you do not want to do mortar projects in the winter. And the reason is, seems common sense, but I've seen a lot of people do mortar in winter. When it freezes, the water in the mortar freezes. If it's still wet and it separates away from that powder and breaks it down. And so you've lost any adhesion, you've lost any strength. Yes, ma'am. So
if you're building something you're filling in behind, would you want to wait a couple of days before you put the fill dirt back in?
No, not necessarily. It'll dry out. Your soil dries out over time. So you can go ahead when you finish the wall and backfill it right away. You don't have to wait until all that mortar dries out. This kind of wall, I would definitely be putting some rubble and some gravel behind, and that's going to add to the drainage behind it. So you don't end up with a soupy mess behind it.
You mean on the ground behind it?
Yeah. So if you're adding rubble or gravel, you're going to add it kind of on a slant behind it. So you'll fill in this space and keep coming here till you hit grade. And you do that just below the cap. So that capstone leaves you enough space to add soil and mulch, so you're not seeing that gravel and rubble behind there. If you're planting behind a wall, everybody wants everything up tight so that the plants are on the wall. Plant them behind, they'll reach to it. Give them some space.
So what type of gravel do you use to fill in, and is there a difference between that gravel and what you're putting as a base?
Good question. What kind of gravel do we use as a base? What kind of gravel do we use behind the wall? And is there a difference? My favorite are gray 67s, they're called. And it's cheap. You're never going to see this gravel. There are some really beautiful gravels for paths. Those are very expensive. Use the cheapest gravel you can find and kind of a medium aggregate. So those gray 67s are great. That stuff sells for like $40 a ton. And it's good and strong. It's miserable under your feet, but it's not going under your feet. It's not for a gravel walkway or a gravel path. That may be gray 57s. But anyway, there, you know, it's that small to medium aggregate, gray, hard, cheap rock. Spend your money on the stone people are going to see. Now you see what he just did there? That is one of my favorite stone tricks. Daniel, puede demostrar con una otra piedra otra vez lo que, como cortarlo. He just cut a straight line with a stone hammer. I'm going to have him show you how to do it again. So what he's going to do is chisel out kind of a simple line along the way to stress it. And you can draw that line. I usually do. I'll take the back of the stone hammer. And then he just keeps hitting in the same places and bam, it breaks. That is the most satisfying feeling when you just kind of cut that line and tap, 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 slam, and it breaks in a straight line. Takes a little practice, but it's fun to do. So you don't necessarily need a wet saw, diamond blade, that sort of thing. That comes in handy when you're cutting tops for a wall. But with these, stone hammer, it's pretty much all you need. Yes, sir.
If I build a wall for the first time, and then if it does not come out well, as compared to what I think, after a month or a few weeks, so can I take down the stones and then reuse them?
Yes. Yeah, the question was, stone's a pretty forgiving material. If you build a wall and you're not happy with it, take it apart and start again. When I owned a landscaping company a few years ago, what I would do if I had a new employee who was being trained as a stonemason, they got trained at my house. I have a stone wall. My neighbors must think I'm insane. That stone wall has been torn down and rebuilt so many times. And everybody's like, why would you tear that wall apart? It's so beautiful. That was the practice wall. So they would come to my house and I'd say, tear it apart and start over. And I'd come out and we'd be giving them guidance, and because they never went to a client's house until they were proficient at my house. And so tear it apart, and I didn't berate them and say, no, not good enough, start again. It was okay. This is where you went wrong. This is maybe what you need to change. Let's pull it apart. Let's try that again. And when that wall was finished and I was happy with it, then they could work at a client's house. So practice, practice, practice. This one was mortared. We do have dry stack. And they would knock it apart. It'll knock apart with a mallet. Daniel, ¿tiene una mallet? La, ¿cómo se dice? Yes, thank you, sir. Mallets, your other favorite tool. These are great for leveling patios, certainly when working with pavers. But it also, it's got the force to break apart the wall without breaking the stone and breaking, damaging, the material you're working with.
So if you break it apart, does the concrete come off easily?
It does, yeah. Yeah, with some force, the concrete will come off out easily. If you've got a piece that has concrete stuck on the bottom and you want to get that out, simply take your stone hammer, take the sharp end of it, and get between the stone and the concrete, stress that joint and whack it. That concrete will come off.
What kind of stone is this compared to that over there?
Excellent question. So this is Mountain Mist Thin, and you can see it's got some iron in it, which gives it that more kind of yellows and tans to it. Some of that depends where it's quarried, certainly, and some depends on the type of rock it is. That's a sedimentary rock, so you'll see those layers. This, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is an igneous rock. This is called Cumberland. Both of these come out of Tennessee. Tennessee, you're going to get more tans and browns in your stone. Pennsylvania, you're going to get more blues and grays, depending where things are quarried. So you can kind of look at a wall and say, oh, that's a Tennessee wall, or oh, that's a Pennsylvania wall. Most of our stone either comes from Tennessee or Pennsylvania. Sí, puede demostrar cómo hacerlo. You can see here we've got the, we're working around the tar driveway area, and it's got kind of a rough edge. Right. So what he's saying is you don't need to use the pretty stones under there. You can use the uglier stones, the ones that are kind of lumpy and funny looking on the bottom there, as long as the top of them's fairly level to work with, but you can fix that level with concrete. But that's where you put the stones that aren't the prettiest, is underneath, below grade, where no one's going to see them.
What do you put in front of the wall? Because there's like that gap. Do you just put soil?
So normally you wouldn't have it up against really rough edged tar like we have it here. You might have it against a concrete driveway, which is going to have a really clean line. So you can take the stone right up to the concrete. That brings up an interesting question too. If you're putting a wall near a concrete driveway, where you're running a risk of hitting that wall, do yourself a favor. Don't damage the wall, don't damage your car. Pull the wall back a foot or so from the driveway and put river rock in front of it. It's a rumble strip. It reminds you as you hit that different surface to pull back onto the driveway before you've damaged the wall or damaged your car. That can be a really expensive mistake. Our last segment is going to be a stone veneer wall. Stone veneer has become really, really popular, and there is stone that is cut to make a stone veneer wall look like a dry stack wall, but we're going to do an applied face to this one with a natural stone with as little cutting as possible. What Danielle is showing you here is he's excavated below the wall, put a base of gravel beneath it for support. And then he's using simple concrete blocks. He can get a curve with a straight concrete block beautifully, as long as you're doing a very gentle curve. You don't want to do a fussy little curve. Design-wise, those don't look good anyway. And it's hard to bend straight lines. So you want to do a very, very gradual curve. These are great freestanding walls. You see them in front of subdivisions a lot now to have a stone veneer wall. They're also great seating walls. So if you have a patio and you want a seating wall for a fire pit area or to add some extra seating or to add some visual structure to your landscape, this is a wonderful way to do it. It would be real, it's doable with 100% natural stone. It's very difficult and very expensive. So starting with a concrete block structure saves you a lot of money, and it makes it a whole lot easier because you're working with a very straight, very rigid structure already. We fill the gaps in between the concrete blocks to give it both strength, and for in the winter, there's no water in there getting in there to expand and mess with the wall, start causing cracks, that sort of thing.
So you're saying you fill in the...
We do fill in the pockets,
so
those holes.
Mm-hmm.
So you're using more water. You can fill those gaps too with gravel, as you know, that's an option. The holes in the concrete block, rather. So now he's just cleaning up that edge.
Gravel.
I'm sorry?
About maybe 5 inches of soil, and then...
Not really, because that's going to keep water in there. So you wouldn't want to put soil in those pockets, because that's just asking for moisture problems.
Okay, como aquí no agarra tanto cemento aquí en medio, por eso se rellenan los bloques de cemento para que quede más macizo. Cuando es 2 o 3 pies de alto, lo que se recomienda es poner una varilla.
Exactamente. Okay. So one thing that Danielle brought up that I forgot to mention is if you're going up higher than this, if this is a big wall, you know, like at the front of a subdivision or something, you want some height to it, or you're building it to do a firewall inside it or something, a fireplace. As you're getting up higher, you want to take a piece of rebar and put it down into that center and set it in the concrete, because that's going to add to the force and the strength on the wall. We love rebar.
How deep do you need to dig to put the gravel footings?
So how deep we dig to put the gravel footings is going to depend on the height of the wall. For a small seating wall, maybe 4 to 6 inches, you're getting up more in the 3-foot retaining wall, we want to go down a good 6 or 8 inches. Okay, so as he's gotten these blocks put together and he can keep moving that in this direction till he finishes the wall, he's going to show you how to start adding the veneer onto it. You want to take very flat pieces of stone. That's going to make your job a whole lot easier. And he's choosing stones. Your corners are going to be the hardest part. Thank you. Getting film cues from the crowd. Thank you, guys. I tend to talk and not pay attention to where I'm supposed to be. So he puts mortar behind the stone, puts it up against the wall, and then uses that stone mallet to tap out any airspace between to get that bond good and tight. One little secret not everybody knows about Danielle is he's also an accomplished chef. That man can cook. He's worked in restaurants in Orlando, Florida. And when we're lucky, on Mondays are our slowest days here. He brings in food and puts it out on the Holland Grill out there. Woo! Awesome.
So come shopping on Mondays.
Come shopping on Mondays. Yes.
So for me to build this wall, I have to cut through the grass. You know, what tool is the best to build up 4-6 inches? Because Bermuda grass is very dense.
To cut, so the best to cut is either, if you're going to cut your grass, you can either use a machete, but if you've got soil underneath there, that's really going to damage your machete. I like we used to call it La Pala Azul, the big blue shovel, with a spade with a very tapered, long, straight edge to it, straight on the bottom. We do sell those inside for homeowner use, but the big ones that are all one integrated piece all the way up into the handle were about 50 or 60 pounds. I can use one of those one-handed, and it does the work for you. Instead of a little shovel where you're working at it all the time, it's all about the tool. Those big, heavy spades, it's amazing. I can one-handed cut out for a tree with one of those. It's doing the work.
So with this
and it'll
process,
go right through saw.
The mortar's gonna be shown?
In this process, yes. He's going to put a joint in between that. Here you're going to see mortar. You can get stone veneer that's already pre-cut that puts it so that you don't see them. This is just a different technique.
But if you don't want to use veneer, you want to use real stone, can you do it and put them closer so it looks like almost a stack?
You'll end up with airspace between it, and then they'll pop off. So you really do need that. It's almost like tile. You can get your joints close, but you still need that grout in between the tile. This technique is a lot like tiling.
So can you get colored grout then?
You can. And we've done that with some of the stone that's more, it has more iron in it, more yellow, more golds in it. You can buy a simple additive at your local big box store that you add to it to get that color. If you're doing a large wall, really pay attention to how much you add in your first mix, because the color will change if you're not adding the exact same amount. So what we would always do is say for one bag of Type S mortar mix, we'd get, you know, a measuring scoop, a half cup measuring scoop, scoop it out, and one of those leveled off completely goes into that mix, because otherwise your color's gonna change and it's not gonna look right.
For a vertical wall, should your mortar be a little bit thicker, a little bit drier than wall?
You don't want it soupy, but really you want it about the same consistency. He is using a lot more mortar because this has to stay vertical. And of course, I mean, this seems like common sense, but it's really important to start with the bottom stones and work your way up. Right. You're supporting those upper stones. Daniel, yeah. ¿Puede terminar aquí? Con porque no tenemos mucho tiempo, entonces necesitamos poner el mortero entre las piedras, por favor.
So gracias. It's a corner stagger, so one side sticks out.
Yes. Yeah, anything you can do as you're going around those corners to make it not look like an obvious joint, so that again, if you've got cut stone veneer, they've cut those pieces to do this, and it all looks like one kind of seamless stone. What you want the look to be is that it looks like it's stone through and through. Yes, sir.
How much wider is your base be than the actual wall that's considered up higher than or something like this? Obviously, the veneer veneer itself should be landing on it as well. So it has some
correct, yes. If you can go 3 or 4 inches wider, like you see here, about 3 or 4 inches wider than the base of the wall with your gravel, that's for the best because it's spreading that strength out. So Danielle's going to finish here, just that one small piece on the corner, and then he's going to show you where his cooking experience comes into use, because he has a really cool tool that he uses to fill in those gaps. And I don't know if any of you are bakers or have done any cake decorating, but it's basically a very large pastry bag with an applicator tip on the end, and he fills it full of concrete and he squeezes it out in between and then uses the trowel to take it off. It's a really cool technique. I have tried it before where you're doing it with a trowel. It makes a mess. It gets mortar all over the front of the stone. This works so much better.
Uh-huh. Is he still using that tool?
He cut that in half with a stone hammer. The question was, when you get to an end, because you're overlapping these like brickwork, your concrete blocks, again for that strength, again so you don't have a seam, they're overlapped like brickwork, and you get to the end and you need half a concrete block. But he did score and break that with the stone hammer.
So do you tap it with a sharp end and then hit it?
Exactly, or you can use a chisel and break it that way as well.
You have multiple people looking at the same wall.
Uh-huh.
Do you start in the middle and both people in the opposite direction, or do you start at either end and come together?
Ideally, you don't want multiple people working on the same wall. And I will tell you why. Everybody's style is different. It's like having 4 artists working on the same painting. It's not gonna work. Everybody has their own feel for the stones they pick and the relationship between them and the gaps between them. Ideally, you want one person and only one person working on that wall. I can tell. I can look at a wall and say, oh, they had too many cooks in that soup. Yep. If you are wondering, can I do this? Helped out my son when he bought his first house. He's moving into his second house next week, and built a mortared seating wall very similar to this. Myself, my son, a couple of his friends, and my husband, and we're out there, and I was doing the mortar on the front because I was the stone veneer on the front. I was the only one who had any experience. And my daughter-in-law, I love her. She's beautiful. Her nails are perfect. Her hair is perfect. Her shoes are perfect, and she was bringing us drinks, and she just kept looking. She disappeared. She came out, hair up, sweatpants on, gloves on, and said, okay, if you can do this, I can do this. And I taught her that day, and she took one part of that stone veneer wall, and it wasn't perfect, but she did it herself, and she was so proud of that. And that was her first experience ever doing stone veneer. So if she can do it, you can do it. All right. Puede poner el mortero entre porque no tenemos mucho tiempo más. Sí. ¿Ah?
No se va a poder porque está fresco.
¿Qué es fresco?
El otro cemento.
Lo siento, sí. Sí, yo sé.
Estamos en la otra clase, ¿verdad?
Ajá.
El medio.
¿Puede solamente un parte chiquito?
Un poquito,
sí.
Ya.
What he's saying is he's going to do something he wouldn't normally do if he were building a wall. He's doing it in the interest of time, which is to pipe that grout in between. He would wait for this to set up more before he did it. Today he's going to show you. So it's one of those do as I say, not as I do. He's going to show you how to put it in between. But normally he would let this set up longer before he did that. Yep. Exactly.
How do you leave, if you're always going to take a couple of days to do it?
Yep.
How do you leave a certain spot? How do you leave the next day when you continue on?
Right. If you're grouting, you want to do that all in one day.
Grouting's
all done in one day. So you finish this part, and then you go back the next day and grout.
You can't finish. Say you have to stop halfway. Mm-hmm. Just make sure all the grout is not spread out.
Yeah, you're only grouting in between the stone where it is. The way he's done it there, it would be fine. You don't want to apply mortar all the way along the front of the wall. So, there's the pastry bag. And you notice he added a little water to it. He wants this a little more liquid than what he used before. So, working through, unless there are any.
Just like this concrete over here, could you start building that?
A wall directly on concrete? Yes, you could. That's really easy. It's already level. In theory, if they poured it correctly, it's already level. All right, so you can see what he's doing there. Squeezing the mortar between, like just like grout, just like cake icing.
How deep should the mortar be? Should it be flush with the stone, slightly back, slightly forward?
You want the grout to come out slightly forward of the stone, because then he's going to take the trowel and point it just like you would with brick. He's going to come in between and make a nice clean line. So you want it to puff out a little bit. Okay. Puede cortarlo un poco con. Pero como limpio lo, ellos quieren ver como limpio las líneas.
Necesitamos después de las 12 para,
sí.
Porque seque para yeah. Tallarle.
He's saying before he cleans that grout line up, he wants it to dry a little bit, and that we probably won't have time to show you that, just because he said that we're in the shade, we're not getting enough sun for this to dry out fast enough. And then any that comes, you can see how some is kind of slopped over the edge. Don't panic. Wire brush takes that off right away. Puede demostrar las tapas y tal vez después puede, tal vez después es un poco más seco. He's going to put the caps on now. When you're putting caps on, you want them to overhang. And that looks beautiful. But it's also very important, and the reason is it's not letting water get down in between the concrete blocks and the stone veneer. Yeah, see, he's not had enough time for that to dry. This is one of those when you're planning it for a class, you don't have as much time as you would have when you're doing the real job. You want to be picky with your capstones. You want them all to be fairly similar in thickness. He's using the stone hammer to cut the edge a little bit so that it's not, somebody sits on it, they're not going to cut the back of their legs, so it's not dangerous. So he's going to put a little on the top. A little bit of the mortar on the top. And he uses the back of that stone hammer again, just to set it in. Check his level. And you can see that overlap. You want a 1 or 2 inch overlap so that it's going to look beautiful, and so that water isn't getting in between. Yes, ma'am, you had a question.
Are those stones preferred for seating versus something like a set paper that you can use on top?
The question was, are these stones better than a paver for a top? No. Pavers are just as good for a top on a wall. But I would put a paver top on a paver wall. I would put a stone top on a stone wall, rather than mixing materials. A lot of times you'll see, though, they'll pour concrete curbing or something to put on the top of the wall. Get a set concrete curbing that looks really good. I mean, you can do that too. A curving wall is a little harder than a straight wall. For a straight wall, they actually, you can buy treads that are already cut. They're all the same thickness. They've got rock faces on the, you know, they've been chiseled on the front. That only works on a,
Las tapas, como son naturales, tiene que ir así, pero si ellos quieren una medida perfecta, 2 inches para cada lado, hay que cortar con la, con la máquina.
Okay, he's saying if you want a really straight edge, leave your stones a little bigger, and then once it's dried, you can go back with a diamond blade and mark your line along there and cut with a, you know, with a chalk or something, and then just cut that line and you've got a perfect curve, perfect straight line. All right, and then he'll leave a gap in between, and when that, again, when it dries, he'll pipe some mortar in between. The tricky spot, of course, is where the overhang is. And so that's when duct tape comes in. We will literally put duct tape over the front and bring it out this way and up the sides a little. And when it dries, pull the duct tape off. And it holds it in that spot. That's just a little trick.